Okay, comrades. In March 1928, a bloke called Richard Mellon appeared before a Senate committee in the States. Mellon was a representative of one of the most powerful families in the United States, a massive force in finance and industry. His brother, Andrew, was arguably the most powerful man in the country. He was the Secretary of the Treasury in America right the way through the 20s. In fact, one of the jokes at the time was that three Republican presidents had served under him. So you get, you know, this very substantial figure, and he appears before this committee, and he's asked questions by the miners' union representative. They have a legal representative there. He's asked various questions, and at one point, he actually put in the record that you could not mine coal without machine guns. I think this throws a certain light, if you like, on class relations in the United States that often doesn't get the attention it deserves. You know, that we know about various great historic massacres and battles, but I would argue that when you look at the history of the United States labor movement in the first half of the 20th century, certainly what you're looking at is a labour movement that faced a degree of repression that is without precedent in any other country with some sort of constitutional government, some sort of democratic government. And what I want to look at really is the dimensions of this, and then to look at the way in which the American labour movement dealt with, confronted, resisted the sort of circumstances that they faced. When Mellon talked about machine guns, he wasn't exaggerated. I mean, later on, in the mid-30s, you have a number of steel companies that are getting ready for a fight with the union. And these companies were very heavily armed. One of the smaller companies, which was not the best armed, but let me read you out their, the armaments that this company had got ready for an imminent strike. They had four machine guns. Not many employers in Britain that actually have four machine guns hanging around ready to deal with pickets. They had 369 rifles, they had 453 revolvers, they had 190 shotguns, they had 200 gas guns, and they had 76,000 rounds of ammunition. This was not the biggest and best armed of these companies. This was pretty much routine that American business was armed. American business in the 20s and 30s, I would argue, was prepared to kill in order to prevent unionization. Now, it wasn't just a matter of the use of violence, you know, I don't think one should underestimate the use of violence, but it wasn't just a matter of the use of violence. In the States, in the 20s, you had a situation where trade unions, in terms of the law, were only semi-legal. You had a phenomenon in the United States, which I think we're beginning to get in this country a little bit more, though on nothing like the scale. You had the phenomenon of the injunction. Strikes in the United States quite often would have an injunction taken out, which to all intents and purposes made the strike illegal. You had injunctions taken out, for example, that on one occasion forbade the union to consult its lawyers about the injunction. You had an injunction taken out on another occasion in one of the coal fields that forbade the singing of hymns at union meetings because they were intimidatory. But my own favourite occurs in the 30s in New Jersey, where a group of restaurant workers go on strike and they are served with an injunction 7 minutes after they've walked out. They're on the picket line for 7 minutes before they're served with an injunction that to all intents and purposes prescribes their strike. So you had a situation of, you know, where to all intents and purposes, unions were semi-legal in some states. To all intents and purposes, unless the union was a union that the employers wanted, they were illegal, full stop. On top of that, there's another phenomenon which I think is often neglected in the literature, and this is the extent to which in the 20s and 30s, the United States for trade unionists was a police state. Now, I use these words very deliberately. If you're a trade unionist in America, an active trade unionist, you expected in the 20s and 30s to be spied on. You expected to have secret policemen in your trade union branch when you went on strike. You expected to have secret policemen on the strike committee. You expected these people to be everywhere. This was part of the sort of the Popular recognition of the time was that you were under observation. And the reason this doesn't figure as a secret police force in the United States, of course, is because being America, it was a private secret police force. By the time you get to the 30s, there are well over 200 private detective agencies. Some of them, like the Pinkertons, were absolutely massive organisations. A conservative estimate, is that in the early 30s, there was something like 40,000 private detectives working inside the trade union movement in the United States. And remember, this is a conservative estimate. You found these people everywhere. A Senate committee investigated this and found in Indianapolis, which is not a town that celebrated for class struggle, that every trade union organization in the city had private detectives spying in its ranks. And they weren't only in the bona fide trade unions, even the company unions that had been set up had private detectives keeping an eye on what was going on. Not only did you have all these companies carrying out spying work, but many firms had their own secret police. The most notorious, as I'm sure some comrades know, is the Ford Company, which had its own private army. But they weren't the only ones. A whole number of firms had their own private army. A whole number of trade organisations employed their own secret police organisations as well. When the workers occupied the Chrysler plant in 1937, they seized control of the company's records. And one of the union leaders, a bloke called Richard Frankenstein, unfortunate name, but that is his actual name, Richard Frankenstein was shocked to find, when they got hold of the secret police records, that his best friend had been in receipt of a monthly payment from the company for spying on him. His best friend. And this bloke was not just someone he was friendly with at work. Their families went on holiday. They celebrated Christmas together. And since the week they met, this bloke had been getting a payment for spying on him. This was the extent to which this secret police operated. And I think if you look at the culture of the time, this is what trade union activists expected. And this was something that you took for granted was going on. And yet when you come to look at the history books, this really doesn't get anything like the attention that it deserves, because you can imagine the difficulties of trying to organise under these circumstances. You know, that you try to organise, a group of you get together, one of them's a police spy, a couple of weeks later you're all fired except that person. You know, this was the sort of conditions that people worked under. Not only that, of course, but sometimes these private detective agencies were used to murder people. They were used to hand out terrible beatings. They played a very vigorous role, if you want to use that word, in the sort of repression that existed in the United States. Now, in the period around the First World War, you do get the American labor movement become very, very strong, very militant. In 1919, there was a great wave of strikes in the United States. There's something like 5 million trade union members. You know, you do have the trade union movement looking like it's riding quite high. But what they confront is an employer's offensive in 1919 that really extends into the early 20s that I would argue turns the tide. If anyone's interested in following this up, I'm not going to go into this, but the West Virginia mine wars are well worth hunting down and investigating. If you don't know anything about it, you will be shocked and amazed by what really is a war that takes place in West Virginia at this time. The film Matewan, which hopefully people have seen, only gives you a pale picture of the scale of what went on. But the decisive struggle, without any doubt, was the 1919 attempt to organise steel, to force the steel companies to recognise the union. And this is really, you know, the decisive struggle. If the unions had won, then this would have shifted the balance of class forces in the United States pretty decisively. What happens, of course, is they go down to a crushing defeat. They go down to a crushing defeat. You have over 20 strikers killed in the course of the strike. You have hundreds injured. You have hundreds arrested. The scale of the repression is absolutely massive. A degree of brutality that I would argue, you know, we have not seen in strikes in Britain, certainly since the early 19th century, a degree of brutality that we haven't seen since the days of the Luddites and whatever. You've got to go back that far. This happens in America in 1919. The movement goes down to defeat. And really, I think if you look at the American movement through the 20s, what you have is a period of decline, retreat. This is the general picture right way through the 1920s. You know, it's the it really, I would say, what's decisive is the scale of the repression. I would argue myself is actually decisive. Then you get the Great Depression. And the Great Depression hits America extremely hard, to the extent that in the early 30s, I don't think there's any doubt at all that you had some thousands of people dying of starvation in what was the richest country in the world. They covered this up as best as they could. This was covered up. Almost anything would be put down on a death certificate rather than death by starvation. But this is freely admitted in a lot of literature at the time, where doctors say, you know, that we have 3 or 4 people a week dying of starvation. Large numbers of people starve. And you have a remarkable situation where in some parts of America, meat is being left to rot because there's no market for it. And you have other parts of America where people are actually dropping down and dying from malnutrition. You know, you have the most appalling circumstances in the States in this period. Far worse than the Great Depression and its impact upon Britain. And this is without even the vestiges, really, of any sort of welfare state. You know, that the balance of class forces in America was such that even the sorts of reforms that the Liberal Party had introduced in Britain before the First World War, these reforms had never really manifested themselves in the United States. They'd never been introduced in the United States. What you get is, you know, people begin to fight. And I think this is absolutely crucial, you know, that no matter how bad things get, you get people begin to fight back. And one of the interesting things at the time that really fits in with our politics, but it's really nice to actually look at an account and say, yes, we were right, you know, this is actually how it does work out. Well, there's a situation where the people who give a lead are the people on the left. You know, you actually have Communist Party members, you have the Trotskyists, you have the IWW, you have a whole number of people, you have independent socialists, a whole number of people, but people on the left actually take the lead in saying we've got to do something about this, in organising to resist evictions. Something I strongly suspect we will be doing in the foreseeable future, organising to resist evictions. Not only evictions, interestingly enough, from rented accommodation, but resisting evictions for homeowners as well. We actually had a situation where they resisted the seizure of houses by the banks, calling in mortgages in the States. You had massive unemployed demonstrations. You had all sorts of struggles taking place. And the evidence is overwhelming that where there was struggle, conditions improved. You know, the evidence is overwhelming. Where people accepted it, then things got worse. Where people fought back, things improved. But you can't rely on the stone hearts of the ruling class. In the end, what stirred people was the fact that there was going to be a fight back, that there was going to be trouble. The Communist Party played a leading role in this. One account, actually a contemporary account, pays tribute to the fact that these people took misery and suffering out of the dark into the light. You know, that they actually took issues up and they campaigned. They were extremely brave, they campaigned against racism, they fought tremendous unemployed struggles, and when there was a strike, the communists were there leading the way. They were certainly the strongest force on the left. There's a downside to the Communist Party. Of course, they were extremely sectarian at this time, the third period, but nevertheless, even some of their most ferocious critics acknowledge that in terms of courage, these people were there. You know, in fact, in the book, I provide plenty of evidence for the heroism of these people confronted with a degree of repression that really we've never faced, at least so far, we've never faced the sort of conditions that these people face. When you get the trade unions actually begin to fight back, you get, as I'm sure people know, the three famous strikes of 1934. You get the Trotskyist-led strike in Minneapolis, you get the great San Francisco strike, and you get the strike that Abraham Mustie led, the Toledo strike. These are three strikes all led by revolutionaries, all led by people who considered themselves to be revolutionaries. Each strike recognised that the state was on the side of the bosses and was not going to accept any notion of relying on the state to weigh in and help them out. Each strike recognised that the trade union leaders would try and compromise, do deals, sell the strike down the river. Each strike recognised the leadership of the strike carried the workers into a recognition that this had to be an all-out confrontation, and only by waging it with the utmost ferocity was there any chance of winning. In all three strikes, people were killed. You know, but most famously, I suppose, in Minneapolis, you actually have a situation where the workers are confronted by an organised group of employers, scabs, and two of the scabs are killed. And the police are investigating this. The one problem they had was that across the bars in Minneapolis, there were some people claiming to have killed them, but they could never actually narrow it down enough, you know. You actually had people fought back, you know, and this was a situation where people had broken legs, people had fractured skulls, and people on occasion died. There is a fourth great struggle in 1934. It's the biggest. It's a nationwide struggle. It's particularly centred in the South. This is the textile workers. This could have shifted the balance of forces in America in a historic fashion. If the South had been opened up to organisation, this in many respects one can say would have changed anything. Everything coming. But what you get is a situation where this union relies on Roosevelt's promises. This union looks for a way out. You have the most tremendous militancy, but in the end, the union leadership, and they're people who do face up to a degree of repression before they decide to call it a day, that one can't imagine that many trade union leaders in Britain at the moment facing up to. But in the end, you know, they accept Roosevelt's promises that he'll look after them. And what happens is an absolutely crushing defeat that sees the textile workers' union virtually ceasing to exist, and Roosevelt's promises count for nothing. And there's actually a statement by one of the leaders of the union, which he does acknowledge. He actually does acknowledge that we trusted the government. You know, he puts it in these words: we trusted the government, and in fact, what we found was that the government takes no notice of the weak and the poor, and only takes any notice of the strong and the powerful. You know, I'm a bit late to have learned that, but nevertheless, this is a lesson learned. And he makes the point that in the end, the workers can only rely on themselves. And I would say what you have in 34 is three great historic strikes that demonstrate that positively. But just in case the penny didn't drop, you also have another great strike that demonstrates it negatively as well. What you get actually break employer resistance to union organisation in the United States. What actually does it in the end, of course, is the great sit-down strikes. You have the General Motors sit-down strike. This is, once again, communists play a very important part in this strike. To some extent, they dominated the writing of the history of this strike and played down the role played by Socialist Party members. And a number of the Socialist Party members later went on to join the Trotskyist movement. So their role is very much played down in the Communist Party accounts. But to be fair, the communists play an absolutely crucial role in the occupation of General Motors. Once again, very militant. You actually have a situation where one of the General Motors executives had visited France in the aftermath of the French factory occupations and had actually told a Renault executive that nothing like this could ever happen in the United States. You know, and then he goes back, of course, and they've occupied his factory. They win. And one of the reasons they win is that they do not accept the compromises that are on offer. They are asked to evacuate the factories, so negotiations will take place. And in fact, the union leaders want to do this. But what happens is a newspaper story gets round that in fact the employers are playing a double game, and the workers take the decision to stay in and not to accept some sort of compromise deal, some sort of mediation. And they win what is a great historic victory. And what happens, of course, is that this victory at General Motors has been watched by people across the United States. They've seen the most powerful company in the world. They've seen the most powerful company in the world taken on by its workers and actually forced to bow down before the union. And this sparks off a wave of sit-down strikes right away across the United States. You get sit-down strikes. There's mines where miners occupy the mine. You get a number of ships being occupied. Some people argue that, one of the most widespread bursts of occupation was actually in the merchant marine, and this has been virtually ignored, but large numbers of sailors occupied their ships. You get Woolworths being occupied, you get occupations taking place right across America, and of course many employers gave in for fear of occupation rather than waiting for it to happen. There were setbacks. Yeah, no doubt about it, there were setbacks. The Hershey Chocolate Company, the workers who occupied the Hershey Chocolate Company were driven out. You know, you can't interfere with chocolate, it seems. But you know, you did have a massive wave of strikes that I would argue shifted the balance of forces in the United States and certainly terrified American employers. Now, the American employing class was split in its response to this, I would argue. You had a lot of employers thought, in the end, let's do a deal with the union leaders and the union leaders will restrain their members. And you did have a situation where John L. Lewis, you know, who was the miners' leader, who was leading, who was the iconic leader of this struggle, if you like. Lewis had successfully put himself at its head. And to be fair to Lewis, he had done this by showing great personal courage himself. Lewis makes quite clear, you recognise the unions, and we will make sure that all this stuff stops. You know, you recognise us, all this stuff will stop. You'll get responsible trade unionism. And you get a situation where the steel is seen as the next big battle. The unions have been defeated in 1919 in the steel industry. Steel is seen as the decisive battle. We tend to think of automobiles as the decisive battle, but I think at the time they saw steel as the decisive battle. And one of the Communist Party's leading industrial experts, Bill Foster, was actually convinced that there was going to be a massive battle over steel, which would lead to general strikes in a whole number of cities, would lead to the mines shutting down as well, because there was no way Lewis would lose. Lewis knew, as far as Foster was concerned, that if they didn't win in steel, everything would go. Lewis would fight it till he won, no matter what the cost. This was Foster's attitude, and this was going to be the decisive battle. The decisive battle was going to be steel. And Foster wrote a number of very interesting pamphlets that are still worth reading today about how you organise. You know, absolutely tremendous stuff. He was an old Stalinist bastard, to be honest, but he wrote a fantastic number of pamphlets, How You Organise Steel, which, like I say, are still relevant today. Well, you know, the fact is the employers were looking at the situation from a sort of anti-Marxist point of view, if you like, and the conclusion they draw was, if we fight over this, there'll be a massive struggle that will shift the balance of class forces in America and will actually put everything at risk. They had exactly the same analysis as Foster, but their intention, of course, was to stop it, whereas he was hoping it would take place. And what you get is a situation where the biggest of the steel companies, US Steel, actually does a deal with Lewis. They recognise the union, and what the union that they recognise is a absolutely top-down union run on almost dictatorial bureaucratic lines, does deals, and over a period of time actually expels many of the militants who helped set the union up. These people are trapped out because they don't fit in anymore. And you actually have complaints from some steel workers that, you know, the union needed us when it was setting it up. Now we're told that we're spoiling things. And if you lost your union card, then you also lost your job because they've got a closed shop agreement. You know, so you have steel sewn up. US Steel, the biggest steel company, is sewn up. What's interesting, though, is like I said, the bosses are split. A whole number of the smaller steel companies, and they're only small by American standards, but a whole number of the smaller steel companies are determined to fight. And the company I mentioned with the four machine guns, this is one of the companies that are determined to fight. And you know, you get in 1937, you get the little steel strike take place. And most famously, I suppose, the most famous event is the Memorial Day Massacre in 1937. The workers actually, it takes place in Chicago. The workers actually occupy the steel plant. They actually occupy the plant, and this is something that Foster had recommended in his massive struggle as he envisaged it, that there were occupations of all the steel plants. They occupy the plant, and union officials come in and tell them to evacuate the plant. There's going to be routine picketing. They're not going to seize the plant, they're going to show they're responsible, but they're going to picket in a respectable fashion. When they get outside, of course, the Chicago police, who are notoriously brutal and corrupt. The American police generally were brutal and corrupt. I mean, not all. There were places where the police actually sided with the trade unions. Not that many, but there were places where the police actually sided with the trade unions. But the Chicago police are notoriously brutal and corrupt. If you're a policeman and you tortured a prisoner, you actually describe your methods yourself as the Chicago way. The use of torture by the American police is actually a historical phenomenon. You know, Abu Ghraib was practiced in American police stations in the 1930s. The Chicago police don't let them pick it. They don't let them pick it. And what you have is a decision on Memorial Day to have a protest march down to the steelworks, and the police open fire. They kill 10 people. They kill 10 people. All those killed are either shot in the back or shot in the side. They're either getting ready to run away or running away. You had a whole number of others who were also shot and wounded. I think of the 30-odd who were shot and wounded, something like 3 were shot in the front, the rest were shot in the back or shot in the side. You have a whole number of people very seriously injured. You have people blinded, you have people permanently crippled by the beatings that the police hand out. One of the men who was killed, a 50-year-old bloke, a youngster, his wife committed suicide a couple of weeks later, out of misery for his death. This is, you know, 1937, Roosevelt is president. Roosevelt has been elected, supposedly as the champion of the people. You have cold-blooded murder carried out on the streets of Chicago. Roosevelt says what is, in a way, it's, you'll find it in history books, he says, a plague on both your houses. Roosevelt doesn't condemn the police, he doesn't condemn the companies. If anything, you know, the implication is that it's the union that's in the wrong, but he doesn't actually come out and condemn the union. Roosevelt says he's sitting on the fence. And the trouble was, of course, that once it became clear that any amount of repression was going to be okay, that the state was going to do nothing to help the union that had actually played a big part in financing Roosevelt's election victory, once it became clear, then what you get is repression just being unleashed, and in fact the little steel strike goes down to defeat. Now, I don't think its defeat was inevitable, even given the repression that was launched. One of the reasons it goes down to defeat is because Lewis has already sewn up the big target he had, which is US Steel. And Little Steel is a nuisance. He'd much rather have them give in, but he's not prepared to risk the escalation of militancy, to risk the generalisation of the struggle, pardon me, which was the only way it could have been won. He's not prepared to risk that. So in the end, you know, they allow the steel workers and the little steel companies to go down to defeat, despite absolutely heroic efforts, you know, in towns where really they were company towns, with a company police force running the town, where, to all intents and purposes, if you were working class or if you were a trade union organiser, you had no civil rights at all. They go down to defeat. Now, what's interesting, I would argue, from our point of view, is that, like I said, the Communist Party plays a very important role in many of these struggles, and individual Communist Party members and Communist Party officials show great courage. They get beaten, they get imprisoned, sometimes they get imprisoned for very long periods. I think it was 1926, someone gets 10 years in California for raising the red flag, which was against the law. The repression is, like I said, something that is far more severe than anything we've encountered in this country since the early 19th century. You get the communists face this out. The trouble is that the Popular Front, I would argue, leads to a change in Communist Party policy. It leads to a change in the sense that they now rally behind Roosevelt. And you actually get the Communist Party they actually argue that there is a Popular Front in America. It is led by Franklin Roosevelt, and we are its left wing. And we will do everything we can to support President Roosevelt. The Communist Party actually pushes its politics that far to the right. In many ways, more interesting from our point of view, I would argue, is their activities inside the trade union movement. Whereas they had argued for rank and file committees, where they had argued in the unions for workers' democracy, for strikes to be worker-led, you would elect committees that would run the strike, you'd have youth committees, you'd have committees devoted to organising workers in different ethnic groups, because America had a very large immigrant population. You know, if you ran a strike in one of the big cities, you would have leaflets in half a dozen languages to hand out. Everything would be done under rank and file control. This was absolutely the Communist Party's touchstone. And then with the Popular Front, what you get is the Communist Party takes the decision that it's going to occupy official positions, and really it's going to be part of the trade union bureaucracy. I would argue that this becomes the Communist Party strategy, become part of the trade union bureaucracy, and it fits in with the Popular Front, because the Popular Front is intended to put pressure on the Democrats, and you can put pressure on the Democrats if trade union officials are proposing resolutions and whatever. You know, the official stance the trade union movement takes can actually be seen as helpful towards Russian foreign policy. In Steele, to organise Steele, Lewis had taken on large numbers of Communist Party activists as organisers, very deliberately as part of a deal done with the Communist Party. Not just Communist Party activists, they took on a whole number of people across the left as organisers. You know, they thought these people they're mad, they don't mind getting their heads cracked, send them in. If anyone can do it, these people can do it. You know, they'll go in, they'll organise. The trouble was that the Communist Party, by the time they're doing this organising, are accepting the idea of unions not being under democratic control. They don't challenge the bureaucracy that is controlling the Steelworkers Union. Instead, they try to become part of it. And once Lewis decides that he's got his deal, US Steel is going to be enough, they've done the business, then what you get is a systematic purge of people who, they give them a choice. To be fair, you can either become one of us or remain in the Communist Party, in which case you've lost your job. But they do give them a chance to sell out. You know, they're not without heart. They do give them a chance to sell out. But what you get is people are removed. The communist influence in the Steelworkers Union is absolutely just removed, and because they haven't built the sort of rank and file organisations that even a couple of years ago had been their bread and butter, it would have been inconceivable not to organise in a rank and file way. Because they haven't done this, they are expelled without any problems at all. You know, and this is, I think, in many ways, the aspect of the Popular Front that tends to be neglected. That what you had was the Communist Party give up the idea of rank and file organisation and instead shift round to the idea of becoming part of the trade union bureaucracy. And even though those unions that the communists do establish bureaucratic control in, is any doubt that by and large, not always, but by and large, these unions are better unions, more militant unions, not always, but by and large, nevertheless, they are run, I would argue, on lines that have more in common, pardon me, with the way in which the trade union bureaucracy traditionally operates than they have in common with the old rank and file strategy that the Communist Party used to advocate. And what you get is a situation where you have a massive upsurge, great historic upsurge in terms of trade union organisation in the United States. You have a massive shift, I would argue, in the balance of class forces. You actually have Roosevelt, you know, whose radicalism is quite often vastly exaggerated. Roosevelt was a very good actor. I mean, there's one account where he sheds tears at the plight of black people in America. Someone tells him how bad things are, and she says he cried. And then, you know, he was asked, what's your position? Lynching, haven't got one. You know, an American newspaper, a black newspaper, came out with a front page, Roosevelt's thoughts on lynching, and they just had a big blank space. And this was at a time when lynching of the most cruel, in the most cruel fashion was routine, and when even the SS in Germany was saying, how come the Americans can get away with this? Well, we do a little thing, and we're pilloried for it. You know, the Americans can castrate a black man and burn him alive, and there's no international outcry, and we beat up a few Jews, and the wound falls in. There's no justice. The SS, some comrade might be surprised though, actually had a theoretical journal. This complaint figures in their theoretical journal. Roosevelt doesn't move to the left. He doesn't introduce the reforms he introduces of any concern for the poor, I would argue. Roosevelt does it absolutely explicitly to head off the threat from the left. I don't think there's any doubt whatsoever, you know, that he could feel, oh, it's a shame, you know, that people are hungry, it's a shame. Oh, look at those kids, what a shame. But in the end, you can think it's a shame and do nothing. But if you think, my God, they're going to come down and burn the house down, then you do something. And I think every reform that is extracted from the American political system in the 1930s is extracted by fear. It's extracted by the fear that if we don't do this, then there's going to be trouble. And this is what we have to remember today. You know, it's quite likely when you look at the polls, today, another general election, the Tories will be wiped out at the current time if you look at the polls, which would be really great. I'd love to see crying, tearing their clothes, hopefully some of them topping themselves. You know, don't get too carried away, but one would like this sort of thing, but then you think, and then we'd have Ed Miliband. And the fact of the matter is, comrades, unless the balance of class forces is shifted, then the difference that is made by who is in power is not that significant. What will decide how we suffer under the current economic crisis, and as it gets worse, the degree to which we suffer, what will decide these issues is the balance of class forces, and can the class win victories? And this is what it's all about. Thank you.
I'm Gareth, I'm from Goldsmiths, Swiss branch. I was just wondering, you were talking about the sort of secret armies of companies, not secret army, secret police, in the early 1900s. Would you say that it was still sort of relevant today with what you see from Coca-Cola in Colombia? I don't know enough about it to really comment any further, but just putting that question to you.
Cheers.
Look, could you please say something about the Wagner Act of 1935, why it was brought in, and what additional rights were given to labour in their industrial relations? Was the Act effective, or were the new rights not affected, or were they clawed back?
Okay, thank you.
My question is about what are the sources in the United States proletariat for, or were there any sources for, anti-reformist ideas? The Western Association of Miners and the Wobblies were around before the First World War. The Palmer Raids were an attempt to knock the top off by deporting back to their countries of origin lots of migrants in the, I think, 1919-1920. And my understanding is that people from the European socialist and revolutionary liberal movements came to the United States in a search of some form of political freedom and brought a lot of radical and revolutionary ideas. The real problem with comparison, one, what effect did that, how did that carry on into the 20s and 30s that we've been told about? But more importantly, and this is a proper question for everybody, not just to our speaker, what are the sources in British society now for revolutionary challenges to reformist ideas?
Hi, I'm David from Oakland, California. I think this is a contribution, not a question. I think that John drew a very useful contrast between the course of the struggles in 1934, between the textile industry strikes, which went to horrible defeats, and the three revolutionary-led strikes. I lived in Rhode Island for several years, which was the northern flank of the textile strikes. And it was a multinational strike led by radicals from several countries, many of them hailing from the Communist Party, but many with different traditions or French socialists. And it was as bloody as some of the other parts of it. And the consequences for the South have been noted, which it's, lynching is connected to the consequences in the South, because the Ku Klux Klan got a rebirth as a result of these strikes, and it's a reign of terror following the defeat of the strikes. And in the North, it meant that the textile industry left, and the state of Rhode Island was in a depression from the late 1920s until the 1990s. And on the other hand, in the strike in San Francisco, which was led by the left, the legacy is completely different. Harry Bridges, who was a leader, communist associated leader of the longshore strikers, saw that the longshoremen excluded black workers, and he went to congregations of black churches and said, we want you to come out and support us in solidarity, and one of our central demands is that we will integrate the workforce. And they got solidarity, and they integrated the workforce, and this is one of the most left-wing unions still in the United States. It's the one that stopped the shipments to and from South Africa in the 1980s, and it's also the union that was the backbone of the port shutdowns during Occupy. We shut them down twice in November and December. It's a completely contrasted legacy, and I'm really impressed by how important the struggles of the 1930s are for setting the tone for even many decades later.
Could you say something about the current American labor movement and attempts to reinvigorate that movement?
Yeah, this is just a question for you. I mean, you're talking about the early U.S. trade union movement and how it kind of had 5 million members, I think, around, was it the 20s? I'm just interested to know, like, your honest opinion on what you think the chances actually were of revolution in the U.S., because there is a consensus, you know, even among radical media that is actually extremely unlikely. You know, there's a very sort of moderate middle class that's always existed in America. You know, I don't think there's ever been a majority of trade union density in the workforce. And you know, I'd just like to know, you know, obviously the Communist Party has been influential, but it's never been, you know, maybe exceeding hundreds of thousands of members, 10,000 at the most. So, thank you.
I'd also like to thank John for a very interesting talk. Just one of the points you made in your talk about how these tactics and strategies are useful for today, and coming from Ireland, there's one of the things that we've noticed in the last really 2 years since the crisis, or the last 3 or 4 years, is the emergence of something similar to the sit-down strikes, workplace occupations. And I think quite similar to the 1930s, maybe you can correct me here, but the tactic of the sit-down was often used to hit the employer very fast, very hard, very quick, before they could actually get, so you'd hit production, so they'd have to make a deal to overcome the legal structures and the impediments that could be put on workers. And similarly in Ireland, it's very noticeable that in the last couple of years, the tactic of workplace occupation by predominantly retail workers, largely young women workers, faced with where shops are being closed down, the redundancy payments are being denied, the tactic now is to have a sit-in and force the employer to make the payment. And the role that the left plays in terms of generalising that, kind of making those connections, is important. But it's also the case that once these struggles start to develop and start to win, that it becomes a new kind of common sense amongst trade unionists or amongst workers. And in that sense, that it becomes generalised through the class very quickly. So a lot of cases now, a lot of young workers in Ireland faced with redundancy, if you're not in a union and your employer is trying to shut your shop down, the first thing you do is you organise a sit-in, don't let them lock the... And I think it's quite similar. Those type of tactics re-emerge, especially in the context of trade unions that are quite moribund and have been tied into the state. I think these are the new tactics that people are rediscovering to fight the crisis that we're fighting today.
Just a brief response to someone who just asked a question a couple minutes ago about union membership in America and the chances of revolution and stuff. Because I'm certainly no expert on this, but I'm lucky enough to have read the book already because I work for Bookmarks Publications. And what you really get from the whole story of the 30s is how it's not just about building up gradually, like a union membership, like that's how you can measure how strong a workers' movement is. Of course, it's related. But what you really got in America in the 30s was this massive volatility where you could see the class struggle in the streets. You could physically see the balance of class forces shifting this way and that in the course of the struggles that took place. And so when you read about 1937, and obviously you've got big unions organising sit-ins and stuff, but it also spreads massively to everyone. Everyone is occupying shop workers and, groups of women and it spreads and becomes a confidence that means all kinds of people start to fight back who wouldn't have thought of themselves as organised workers in that sense. And there's just some brilliant little stories in it. And there's one about a factory, I can't remember what it is now, but it's also a factory where lots of women work, and one woman has got dreadful conditions in terms of, heat and the machinery and safety and stuff. One woman faints because of the conditions, and everyone's outraged, but they're like, okay, we're not quite ready to do the sit-in yet, so we'll just get her to ask her to faint again later when we've organised it, and then they get her to faint again, and then they all walk out in outrage and stuff. It's just like this, there's lots of brilliant little stories of that kind of thing, where it's not about what do we already have in terms of organisation, it's about how confident we feel to say we've got the right to demand something, and so... But the other half of the story is about leadership and stuff as well, because you're kind of tearing your hair out when you're reading about the Communist Party on the one hand and their various twists and turns and how the decade ends up with really the left kind of communist informing on Trotskyists to the HUAC and all of this kind of thing. So it's kind of a massively inspiring but also really frustrating, but it's a lesson in how it's really about the forces on the ground, and if you forget that, then you really lose your compass altogether.
Just two points. The first one is one of the things that always struck me in relation to American labour struggles is that when the struggle happens, it happens in a way much more dramatic and much quicker and much more violently than it tends to in this part of the world, certainly in Britain or in Ireland. When you see the film Matawan or see any sort of documentaries about labour struggles, that they are much more violent. And I often wonder whether the lack of an organised social democracy holding the trade union movement, on the one hand it's a weakness, on the other hand there's a potential strength. And that's kind of a question, I'm not quite sure about that. The other is in a sense the picture that we've been given is quite a bleak one, the struggles were defeated in the 1930s ultimately. But the other thing that has always struck me is that the struggles that emerged in the 60s, that most, or a lot of the leading people in the 1960s were the kids of people who were molded in the 1930s. The kids of the Trotskyists, kids of the Communist Party, kids of the activists of that time. So whereas the labour movement that emerged in the 60s was weak, there was still a radical tradition in America, and it's a radical tradition which I suspect is still there, as we can see in some of the things that have happened over the last few months.
I'm Charlie from New York, and I've done some study of this period, and I actually want to argue that, in fact, revolution probably was not possible at any point in the 1930s in the U.S. There wasn't a significant and weighty layer of revolutionary-minded workers for that to happen. But what was possible very clearly was an independent labor party and a break with the Democrats, a trade union movement with a significant layer of shop stewards, rank and file activists, independent of the bureaucracy, and a much larger layer of socialist workers. And to me, the sort of tragedy of this period and the shift of the Communist Party's perspective, which left almost no opposition to the emerging bureaucracy around Lewis, is that all of those opportunities were wasted. And what you get by the end of the Second World War is a labor movement that is highly bureaucratized, tied to this capitalist party. And basically, the Communist Party, through its strike-breaking during the Second World War, sets itself up for its expulsion from the labor movement, and you now have a situation where the influence of radicalism in the labor movement and in the working class in the U.S. is weaker than it's been at any point in the last century.
Bill Brown from Manchester. I would be interested in the contribution of the American Communist Party, and particularly people who were writers, directors, people like Sam Wanamaker, who was forced out of America under the House on American Activities, McCarthyism. There's a program, Who Do You Think You Are?, with his daughter Zoe Wanamaker, the British actress, went through life of a father, proud of a father. But, you know, Stalinism, all pervasive and horrible and nasty, still did throw up some amazing heroic characters in the CPUSA. People like Angela Davis, who was stitched up on Werner Rapp, I think, under Ronald Reagan. People like, who were close to the Communist Party, if not actually joined, people like Paul Robeson, the actor, the director, the athlete. Now, amazing, brave people who fought within the arts in America. People who were blacklisted as liberals, people like Edward G. Robinson, who played the gangster movies. And then people who informed on people. People were called and asked to inform on their colleagues and comrades, people like Sterling Hayden. Ronald Reagan, the American president, I think he was head of the Actors Union at one time. They were absolutely hysterical. And I think in some movies at the time, I think one was the H.G. Wells War of the Worlds, where you could actually counterpose the Martians against the Earthlings as Russia and America. You know, they could use that as right-wing propaganda vehicles as well. So there's quite a lot of struggle that went on in the world of the media and acting, directors and writers and so forth in America. I think we need to take into consideration. Thank you.
What the Irish comrades said about the situation in Ireland, I think, is very interesting. You can see it absolutely in the States in the 30s. In Detroit, after the General Motors occupation, you actually had, Detroit became sort of crucible, if you like, of the sit-down movement. You actually had a situation where the United Automobile Workers offices were being contacted by working class men and women who said, we've occupied our plant, can you send someone round to recruit us into the union? And they'd go round, and of course it wasn't a car plant. Their people were occupying all the way across Detroit. They weren't in a union. They heard about the occupations. They discussed it, and they decided that an occupation was the way to deal with their situation. So they chucked the boss out, they chucked the foreman out, they occupied the plant, and then they looked round for someone, for a union that they could join. You know, then they looked round. You actually had a situation where large numbers of workers who were not in a union and who had never entertained the idea that joining a union was something they would get away with, as the balance of class forces shifted, these people became confident that in fact they could do it. They'd seen other people do it. They'd seen what was regarded in many respects as the strongest company, the most powerful company in the world, General Motors. They'd seen General Motors bought low, and if that could be done, then they could bring their own employer down. And I think this is the way it works, you know, that working class men and women saw what was going on, took inspiration from it, and decided, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. Now, one of my favourite occupations, I must admit, I mean, one of the delights of working on that book was to find so many stories of struggle where you actually have people dealing with very difficult circumstances and working out tactics and strategies in order to deal with it. One of my favourites is a washing machine plant, the Maytag washing machine plant, where they'd gone out on strike. And the employers, there was something called the Mohawk Valley Plan in the States. And it was a strike-breaking plan. And I'm still investigating this. I think they imported it to break the miners' strike in the 80s. You know, the Mohawk Valley plan is imported into Britain to break the miners' strike. And what you have is, part of it is a back-to-work movement. You launch a back-to-work movement. And they launch this movement, and they condemn the union leaders as a bunch of Reds who are trying to overthrow the government. There's going to be a back-to-work movement. And they sit down there, and they've got fingers crossed, you know, bosses all sitting there. And they see thousands of workers coming down the road. They say, well, it's worked, you know, it's actually bloody worked. They say, look, some of the union committee have given in at all. It's worked. And they all pile into the factory and they occupy it. And they chuck the bosses out and they raise a CIO banner over the plant. You know, this is the working class sitting there and saying, this is how we're going to do it. This is what we're doing. We're confronting this challenge, this is what we're going to do. And I think, you know, I know that I wrote the bloody book, but a lot of what went on in the States in this time is absolutely inspirational. And what makes it all the more impressive is when you know what they were up against, because they were up against a scale of repression that, you know, we can be grateful, really, that we have not confronted here yet. And I always use the word yet, that we have not confronted here yet. And it's absolutely inspirational. And these are, we talk about American workers, we are talking about workers, in fact, from all over the world. You know, that you find that there's a very large immigrant community in America, including British and Irish immigrants who quite often play leading roles in the struggle. I mean, at Chrysler, they warned people about working for the boss because our head of security is a former captain in the IRA. And he knows how to deal with traitors. And this was the warning that was put out. You actually have people taking on one of the strongest, most powerful, and an extremely ruthless ruling class. They take them on and they drive them back. Now, I don't think you had a revolutionary situation. I don't think you had a revolutionary situation in America at the end of the war. I don't think you had a revolutionary situation in the 30s. I don't think it was inevitable that it wouldn't develop that way. I think a good case can be made that Roosevelt made enough concessions to save American capitalism. Even then, a good case can be made that he still cocked it up and, you know, he precipitated another recession by a program of cuts in the late 30s, and the war actually does the business. It's the war that saves American capitalism in the longer run. But certainly, you know, the problems they face, you had a very strong capitalist class, and that capitalist class had made very good use of racism over the years. And, you know, when you look at the condition of white workers in the United States in the 30s, one thing can be absolutely certain is that the conditions were worse for black workers. You know, absolutely routinely, no matter how bad it was for white workers, it was worse for black workers. You actually had a situation as well where sections of the trade union, as I'm sure comrades know, actually operated on an all-white union membership policy. And in the late 30s, you still had a situation in Tampa, for example. The shipyards are organised, they're organised close shop, and it's a union that has a white-only membership policy, and all the black workers working in the Tampa shipyard are sacked, you know, at the insistence of the trade union. This is in the late 30s. So you can see the sort of problems that black workers faced. There were certainly, in the industrial unions, this was overcome in many circumstances. You still had a lot of racism. But in the craft unions, it was a much more difficult job. You know, in the craft unions, you get racism holding on in a way that it's undermined and challenged and fought against in the industrial unions. But, you know, it is heroic, inspiring, but then when you look at the politics, you do confront the politics of the Communist Party. And there's absolutely no doubt one of the tragedies of the 20th century, I would argue, is that you had so many really good trade union militants, really good socialists, artists, playwrights, you know, there is a massive left-wing arts movement in the 1930s in the States. I mean, people have ever seen that the film, The Cradle Will Rock. This is the true story. You know, the play, an opera, in fact, was put on at the time of the steelworkers' strike, and it's about a steel strike. It's directed by Orson Welles. You know, this and it's in fact closed down and has to be put on as a sort of underground play. In fact, the film is well worth watching if you can get hold of The Cradle Will Rock. You had all this going on, but in the end, what you had was many of the best leading militants in America subjected themselves to, you know, Stalin's tyranny and were prepared to twist and change their policies to fit in what Joseph Stalin argued. If you weren't, you left the Communist Party, but large numbers of them stuck with it. And you have a remarkable situation, for example, in the clothing trade in New York and in Chicago. You have large numbers of Jewish workers, many of them either communists or sympathetic to the communists. And then suddenly you get the Hitler-Stalin pattern. And what you have is large numbers of Jewish workers are confronted with the idea that suddenly the Nazis are not too bad. And the Communist Party actually put out a pamphlet arguing that the British Empire is just as anti-Semitic as the Nazis are. Now, the British Empire was anti-Semitic, you know, but it wasn't as anti-Semitic as the Nazis were. They didn't even believe it themselves. I don't think they believed a word of what they put out. They put it out because that was the line. And this is a great tragedy. Even though there wasn't a revolutionary situation, an opportunity to build the left is thrown away because for reasons which, you know, we can't go into and I don't think have been ever properly established, so much of the left, so many of the best of the left, actually supported the Soviet Union. So this I think is you know, the downside of it. And if you buy the book, you know, you'll see that the twists and turns of the Communist Party are often quite shocking. In terms of the Wagner Act, I mean, it's very interesting. Robert Wagner, a lot of people argue Robert Wagner is the most important reformist in this period. You know, Robert Wagner is the man who actually means it. Roosevelt will go along with things because he thinks there's no alternative, but Wagner is the man who actually means it. When you look at the Wagner Act, there are two responses to it, really. The Communist Party at the time absolutely condemned it as an attempt to undermine the trade union movement. I think, you know, what the intention was, in fact, was to provide a legal basis for the development of conventional trade unionism. I think this was the intention behind the Wagner Act. And while the Communist Party condemns it, you know, they were condemning it from a very sectarian ultra-left point of view. The proper approach for the left, I would argue, would be to exploit it and push it further. But nevertheless, what you have is this legislation is introduced. And what it shows, interestingly enough, another thing that's often left out, is in the American Congress, there were a lot of congressmen and women who were to the left of Roosevelt. You know, Roosevelt is seen as the great liberal champion, but there are a lot of congressmen and women who weren't socialists, but nevertheless they were more radical than Roosevelt. And certainly Wagner was one of them. Roosevelt made quite clear on a number of occasions he didn't support the Wagner Act, then he went along with it. He often used to not support things, and then when it looked like they were going to get through, he'd say, that was my idea. He was what's known as a politician. A big section of the American ruling class weren't prepared for even the idea of conventional trade unionism. You know, responsible trade unionism where you do a deal with the officials and the members do what they're told. Now, there might be the odd argy-bargy, but nevertheless, in the end, you have a working relationship. This was not acceptable. And there was a strong belief on the part of very important sections of the American ruling class that the Supreme Court would strike it down. And there's a growing body of literature. I mean, in America, the history of the labour movement is much more, historians working in the field, there are a lot more of them than there are in Britain. And I think they're doing a lot better work than is being done. It's sort of shrunk in Britain. I blame Tony Blair, but it shrunk academic history and the academic interest in the history of the labour movement. Whereas I think it's still very rigorous in the United States. And what you have is a whole number of scholars are looking at the legal history of the American labour movement and the relationship between law and working class action. And what's been argued very convincingly, I would say, is that the Wagner Act, the Supreme Court, weighs the situation up and they look at it from all legal points of view, and in the end they say, if we veto this, there's going to be a fucking boom murder. And I think this is the legal consideration in the end led them. You know, that this is what it came down to. In the end, it was the thought that, you know, they're all hell will be let loose if we knock this on the head. And what you have is a situation now where it does become a tool for conventional, for imposing conventional trade unionism, but also what you get is it being undermined at every step of the way that they can. You know, the employers still say how to undermine it. One last point. There's no doubt that the strength of the American employing class is huge in the States. You know, this is a very powerful ruling class, very rich. Controls, you know, institutions. I mean, one of the things that I came across in the book is that one of the founders of the American Public Relations Movement brought out a book which was a bestseller and was actually made into a film, arguing that Jesus was the first really successful businessman. And you actually have a situation in the early 30s where the Federation of Manufacturers in America, the National Manufacturers Association, someone actually proposes God for membership. You did have the ideological, the American business had a sort of ideological domination as well as a physical domination, and this is what the workers were up against, what the left was up against. And you know, another point worth making, of course, is that not only that, but American politics was corrupt in a way that we haven't seen in this country yet. You know, you would have a situation. I mean, I don't know if any of you watch that Atlantic City program on the telly. Atlantic City was an absolutely corrupt town. In which elections were always fraudulent, and the bloke who ran it, Nookie Johnson, they called him a different name in the programme, you know, was in bed with the mob. And the police chief, the police were murderers. And you had a whole number of places, Kansas City, Pendergast's machine, New Jersey, Frank Hay, Chicago, New York. These were absolutely corrupt cities where the politicians, you know, were in bed with big business, with crime, and whatever. And once again, this created enormous problems for the American labor movement. You know, I mean, I'll end with this one point. You know, there's a lot of stuff about the role of the mafia, for instance, in the American trade unions. There's no doubt this did take place. You know, absolutely no, everyone knows it, I'm sure, you know. But the important point, of course, is that there is organized crime involvement in every institution. In the police, you know, very heavily involved in the police. In the judiciary, very heavily. In politics, in Hollywood. You know, they made a lot of films about gangsters, but they were absolutely in bed with gangsters in Hollywood. Having to go at the trade unions for it, it's absolutely criminal that the trade unions, that some unions were involved with the mob, but nevertheless, the way in which in America the focus is on the mob, is on the unions, is all part of an anti-trade union platform, you know, because the organised crime was everywhere. But you had one situation where one trade union official in New York actually goes to the police to complain about how they're trying to move in and take over his union, and he goes to court, and he's got police protection, and the police chief, the police captain who's protecting him, says, if you go ahead with this, your wife's going to be kidnapped and tortured to death. He says, well, aren't you going to protect me? He says, no, I'm delivering the message. Your wife's going to be kidnapped and tortured to death. And the bloke says, I withdraw my evidence. You know, and this was the sort of situation that American workers were up against. What do you do? You know, if the mob come down and say, we want to appoint the treasurer of your union branch, if you don't agree, we'll kill you. You go to the police, and the police say, they'll kill you. What do you do? Nothing like this in our experience. You know, and this is what American workers were up against. And this is quite often what American workers triumphed over as well. So.